construction of Sika. Funding for Firing Line is made possible by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated. Additional support is provided by the Mobile Corporation. L. John Polite, Jr., the Friends of Firing Line, and by the financial support of viewers like you.
Welcome to Firing Line. I'm Michael Kinsley of the New Republic magazine. Once upon a time, Dartmouth College in Hanover, New Hampshire had a reputation as the most bucolic Ivy League school. Its students were best known for their fondness for athletics and alcohol. In recent years, though, Dartmouth has become famous as a seething cauldron of politics. What City College of New York was to the 1930s, what Berkeley and Columbia were to the 1960s, Dartmouth is to the 1990s. Dartmouth's political reputation varies depending on whom you talk to. To the right, it has become a symbol of liberal trendiness, purging its curriculum of perceived overemphasis on Western culture, offering courses on subjects like black womanhood and the history of clothing, punishing dissenters from liberal orthodoxy. To many others, though, Dartmouth has come to be thought of as a center of racism and reaction. This is due primarily to the antics of a student newspaper called the Dartmouth Review, which is raucously right-wing and has spawned imitators throughout the country. Charles Sykes has written a new book called The Hollow Men, Politics and Corruption in Higher Education. Most of the book is dedicated to what he calls the deconstruction of Dartmouth. Mr. Sykes is a former editor of Milwaukee Magazine and author of an earlier book called Prof Scam, Professors and the Demise of Higher Education. Here to defend his university is William Spengemann, who has been a professor of English at Dartmouth since 1984. Professor Spengemann's specialty is American literature. Mr. Buckley, you've written a couple columns about the most recent Dartmouth Review class, which concerned an anti-Semitic quote from Mein Kampf, which somehow or other got into the published logo of this student newspaper. Now, as you pointed out, the editor did apologize, but I've never seen an explanation or justification for the way he apologized. He said the perpetrator was, quote, human filth that will be sought out and thoroughly punished, and blah, 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 sort of classic Nazi rhetoric. I've never seen an explanation or let alone an apology for that.
Well, I think that's a high pitch of Freudian analysis, that people who are upset and to express how upset they are engage in bombastic rhetoric, are subconsciously imitating the manners of Adolf Hitler or his rhetoric. If he had underdone his apology, I'm sure people would have thought that it was insufficient. His having overdone it, it may be the expression of a 19-year-old style. But the fact of the matter is that it is now, as I understand it, established that the person who did this was a mischievous, cranky, unsettled young man. And it is inconsistent with the published record of this particular weekly that they should engage in anti-Semitism. What is, I think, remarkable is that the president of Dartmouth should almost so greedily have seized on this incident to prove something that he ought to have had every reason in the world not to want to prove, namely that there was a nest of Nazis or neo-Nazis in his own campus. Have I got anything wrong so far?
No, I think what's interesting about this recent episode is it reflects a long pattern. The promiscuity at schools like Dartmouth with which administrators leap to accuse critical voices of being racist, sexist, fascist, homophobic, in this case, Nazi. And I think the facts of this case, this act of sabotage, are still a little bit muddy, but it was clearly an act of sabotage. And what was striking was the leap to judgment on the part of the administration, mm-hmm. which immediately held rallies against hate, said the Dartmouth Review criticizes blacks because they're blacks, women because they are women. What I think is interesting about this is there's a lot of discussion about the whole atmosphere on campus today being politically correct, a new McCarthyism on campus. And this, I think, what attracted me to the whole Dartmouth case was I think you can almost trace the development of this kind of intellectual atmosphere on this very, very small college. where you find a student newspaper that has really over the years challenged this liberal arts college's commitment to tolerance and to the diversity of ideas. And unfortunately, the college has not really passed that test very well.
Have you got a comment on that, Professor Spengemann?
Well, I think the college is, as a result of all this brouhaha, quite an interesting place to be these days.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly, I suspect, more interesting than it was when 4 years at Dartmouth College was like 4 years duty in a submarine. That is, when there were no roads up there and you went up and holed up in an igloo for the winter, you know. It's really quite a bustling place, a lot going on. Necessarily, when the issue is as sharply defined as it is at the college these days, there's a great deal of foolishness on both sides. And I think that foolishness takes the form of people rushing to supply answers before questions have been asked. There seems to be very little inclination on either side to understand the motives of the other side and to assume, even for the purposes of starting an argument, that the motives of the other side are
defensible,
are benevolent.
Mm-hmm.
The immediate assumption is that the other side must be acting out of some malevolent principle, and to impugn the motives of the other side, and that's what heats up the debate. That if
but that's an interesting intellectual question, isn't it? Because you know, the presumption is that everybody is benevolent, right? On the other hand, one reaches a point in which one is required by intellectual rigor to say, no, you know, this, you may think this is benevolent, Professor, but I'm terribly sorry, it really isn't. You're screwing up the curriculum, you're disorienting people morally and intellectually, and whatever you think of it, it's malevolent in its impact. Now, that point has to be reached, doesn't it? And certainly, President Friedman has reached it in respect of the kid editors, and the editors have reached it in respect of the dominating axis in Dartmouth. So oughtn't one to proceed past that benevolent point?
Oh, yes, I'm just talking about as a starting, point. That is, and then when you start that way, then what you do is engage in some kind of analysis of the opposing point of view, right? And you...
Sure. Which Mr. Sykes does.
Yeah, you analyze it. Well, yes, no, right? That is, the book is largely a polemic rather than an analysis of the situation. That is, we're not really told...
Like Burke?
I'm sorry, we're not really told what... polemics is not a bad word in, mm-hmm. in my view. It's just calling a thing by its right name.
Mm-hmm.
And distinguishing it from an attempt to explain or to understand what the sociological and historical stew is that all of this arises out of. Sorry.
I think it's important to point out, first of all, what the nature of the intellectual climate on American university campuses is today. And that, I think, is something that the public's only really beginning to understand. The idea that under the banner of something like diversity, that you find the imposition of the new political orthodoxies that go so far as to include formal limits on free speech on university campus. I'm sure that there are interesting sociological roots to that. But I think the nature of the problem needs to be addressed. And I also want to pick up on something else that Professor Spengemann said, because he's absolutely right. One of the striking things about campuses today, particularly Dartmouth, is how divided they are. And how one is struck by the absence of a middle ground, the absence of the moderate voices, the so-called principal liberal voices, who have not spoken up against the worst abuses on their campus.
You know, why don't we hear more from Professor Spengemann?
Well, yes.
Rather than from the sort of spastic types.
Well, for example, yes, and within the disciplines, for example, there are, I think, very responsible approaches to women's studies and to minority studies.
Well, while you're on that point, let me ask you an entirely serious question, which is, I hope, non-polemical. And I've given this some thought. About 7 or 8 years ago, I was invited to be the commencement speaker at Vassar. And the publication, the invitation having been published, groups of students formed to protest and so forth. So I thought, you know, the hell with this. I have other things to do on Sunday afternoons. But here's a partial list of some of the courses that and intellectual trends that are ripe in Dartmouth as elsewhere, listed by, say, post-structuralism, reader-response criticism, gender studies, Lacanian psychoanalysis, critical theory, canonicity, semiotics, cultural materialism, reception aesthetic, the new history, the new historicism, film theory, critical legal studies. Now, it may be that a college seized by these neo-disciplines encourages the kind of misdirected thought that concretely, for instance, results in Angela Davis, of all people, mm-hmm. being invited as the principal speaker to celebrate the introduction of women in college there. And could it be that it is in a cauldron in which these things figure, that somebody like President Friedman rushes to believe that the Dartmouth Review has neo-Nazis?
You would protest against Angela Davis's appearance at the college?
Oh, I think it's a hideous moral act. She was she ran for Vice President of the United States on a Stalinist ticket. I would just assume you'd invited George Lincoln and Rockwell to celebrate whatever the hell he could celebrate for. Sure, I would protest.
Well, she was not selected just as a speaker on campus. She was selected as the keynote speaker of the celebration of 10 years of women's studies.
That's
and,
right,
she was,
yeah.
And she was introduced as an example of what black women can be. Mm-hmm. No reference was made to her political or to her checkered legal past. And I think that was what objected. In fact, Dartmouth has a long tradition of inviting controversial speakers.
Well, I lectured there 15 times in 15 years during the time that they invited controversial speakers, so I know about that.
But I think you're right when you point out that I think that at the center of what you find is, I think, a vacuum.
Yeah.
A lack of a sense of what a college education should be.
Instability.
An instability. And I think that one of the reasons I call the book The Hollow Men is because I think that you've developed an elaborate institution that teaches students how to deconstruct and dismantle their civilization.
Mm-hmm.
And render it meaningless, but gives them no tools to put anything back in its place. And that really, you almost need to look at the university as an institution that has lost its moral bearings and the ability to define what it is that students ought to learn. Otherwise, you can't really explain how it is that you can graduate from so many institutions of higher learning without ever studying any history, without ever studying any literature, without ever taking a course in philosophy.
Yeah.
So what you have is you do have students who learn how to deconstruct great works of literature without having been trained in critical thinking, who are able to tell you about the economic imperialism of the West without ever taking a course in economics.
Yeah, Professor Spengemann, you have a very orthodox, I may say highly disciplined intellectual and academic background. You've written important books. Surely you have reservations about a curriculum that permits people to go 4 years without ever being exposed to Shakespeare.
Well, I would begin that question by asking how it is that Shakespeare came to occupy that place in your mind.
Mm-hmm.
That is a historical occurrence. Shakespeare's eminence...
Well, I got no problem with that if you want me to answer it.
Shakespeare's eminence is not coeval with his own history. excuse me, Charles lists a couple of places in the book, great works that people should know, but there's no consideration of how those books came to be on that list or...
Can we simply postulate that any credible list ought to have those on it?
You can, and begin that way, and then their appearance on the list is not open to argument.
Yeah. I was on the panel of the new great book series of, in Chicago, and there were lots of quarrels about which the last 20 books ought to be, but none whatever about which the first 80 ought to be. I can't imagine anybody saying Shakespeare doesn't belong there.
I can imagine someone saying it if you put me in the right period of time.
Well, but...
That is, if you put me in the middle of the 18th century, I can imagine somebody saying that. I can also imagine it at the time when the only way you could learn Shakespeare in American colleges was to join a Shakespeare club off campus because it was not allowed in the curriculum.
I know, but surely the idea of education is to take you from dark intellectual ages into lighter intellectual ages, and unless we assume that some kind of intellectual and aesthetic progresses can be made, then one wonders whether the whole exercise is nihilistic. There was a time when Bach manuscripts were used to paper the walls in cathedrals in which he had served as cantor.
Right.
It was 100 years before the St. Matthew's Passion was replayed. But that is an aesthetic darkness from which we would hope definitively to have emerged.
Yeah.
But in
like the Greeks, we always see our own position as the light and everybody else's
well,
as the darkness.
Except that I think the debate is larger than the implication that you're making, that it's just we can disagree about which books belong on the curriculum.
Mm-hmm.
The attack now is not so much on the specific authors, but on the very idea that some books are better than other books,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
that there are standards by which you can judge,
oh.
that there is such a thing as literature, that we can distinguish between books written by dead white males like Shakespeare and comic books.
Mm-hmm.
The thrust behind many of the kind of theoretical developments that you were describing really is an attack upon that very the very idea of intellectual judgment. So that you're not dealing here on the fringes of what my list would look like versus Professor Spengemann's list versus your list, but on the very idea, I think, of intellectual quality.
Well, also,
I don't think
also of said... intellectual adjudication. I mean, if anybody says, let's have a quarrel as to whether Terry and the Pirates or Hamlet is more profound, that quarrel ought to last for only long enough for you to make a judgment on it. And anybody who disrespects that judgment simply hasn't got the faculties that people go to college to be trained in. But as I understand it from your book, in Dartmouth and many other places, you go there and not only are your correct intellectual and moral inclinations satisfied, they are disputed. And you leave with a feeling of emptiness, which is not the idea, is it?
No, it was certainly not, I think, the traditional idea. I mean, there are other ways of looking at the traditional liberal arts college as a place where, in fact, we once did see a place where man learned his place within society, within history, within the universe, that he had some sense of his moral, ethical traditions, of his literary traditions, of his historical past. And within that context, you had a great conversation between
sure.
very disparate points of view.
Sure.
Now, what you're getting now is not only this curriculum that's often denuded of content, but you do get the politicized classes, which don't start with the question of the Socratic dialogue,
mm-hmm.
but they start with the answers.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So that not only are you not getting the kind of things that many of us assume lie behind an educated man or woman, but that you do find this politically correct orthodoxy. And one of the things that struck me at a place like Dartmouth, going through the reading list, was the number of courses where the reading lists were so ideologically uniform, where the idea that ideas can be pitted against one another and challenged was totally absent. And I think that's what you get when you get into this mentality that you can create these disciplines that divide the world into oppressed and oppressor.
Yeah. That's an interesting point. And I'd like to ask you that directly. I hope it won't embarrass you, but the famous case of Professor Cole, he was a music professor and he was black. The kids actually recorded 1 hour of his class, which consisted mostly of lewd references to this, that, and the other, complaints about racism, and so very little about music. And now this was turned into a racist expose. Why should it have been motivated by racism in the judgment of the critics of the people who transcribed that lecture?
The Cole case is hideously complex. I think I presume to make no judgments on it at all. The atmosphere is ripe for someone attacked for any reason to attribute that attack to context rather than to text.
But that's disreputable, isn't it?
I'm sorry.
That's disreputable, isn't it?
It is wherever it appears. But whenever anybody can say, I'm simply being attacked because of some category of some kind, mm-hmm. rather and choose not to defend his or her own position on its own merits, that's a problem. But the atmosphere is ripe for that.
But this is the atmosphere that's dominating this, the victim politics, the politics of accusation, the fact that you cannot criticize the teaching or the conduct of a black professor for risk of being called a racist. And mm-hmm. I think that this is one of the things that has definitely shaped the political climate and the intellectual climate. There are so many professors around the country who are now saying that they will not teach courses dealing with race relations because the intellectual climate on their campus is such they can be attacked whatever they do or they don't say. In the case of Professor Cole, you had a professor whose competence was obviously lacking, who physically threatened co-eds on his campus with bodily harm, who went to dormitories and pounded on the doors of co-eds on that campus, who broke the camera attachment of student journalists attempting to interview him. Mm-hmm. And yet was never disciplined. The students were the ones who were disciplined. There you have an inversion of normal standards of justice, I think, of fair play, and can only be explained,
which is,
I think,
institutionally embarrassing.
Very institutionally embarrassing.
I don't ever understand, Charles. On the one hand, you say that students are being deprived of judgment. That is, they no longer can
make... judgment, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, no, wait, are you talking about disciplinary or are you talking about intellectual?
I'm going to make a second point, all right? That on the one hand, they're told that nothing is more right than anything else, and then in the next breath, you tell us that they're being told continually what's right and what's wrong. And the conflict seems to be between two different groups of people who believe that different things are right and wrong.
No. See, I think that you have hit on one of the paradoxes, which is that the politically correct approach to these issues begins with the idea of deconstruction. Mm-hmm. The idea that if we can't undermine the state structures, we'll undermine the structures of language. We'll tell you that all beliefs are equal. We will undermine your understanding of history. We will deconstruct ethics. But there's a limit to that deconstruction. The idea is not to leave a blank slate. It is to clear the field for the imposition of often very, very draconian ideological perspective, so that you see in the new history, we may have destroyed the hegemony of fascistic facts, but only to clear the way for a more politically correct history. We may have cleared the field of white, male, oppressive ethics and sense of justice, only to have opened the door for the kind of very draconian limits on speech and conduct that you find at schools like Dartmouth.
I made this point in a book I wrote 40 years ago, Got Mad at Yale.
Yes, precious.
I said Yale gets away with a lot because of academic freedom, but don't think for one minute that there isn't an orthodoxy at Yale. There's the correct way and the incorrect way to think. 23 out of 23 members of the faculty of the political science department voted for Truman over against Dewey. Now that wasn't necessarily an aesthetic preference. It's true in that situation. I was criticized as mostly behind doors as, you know, that Catholic. So that there's a sense which I understand for personal reasons. Your point that one reaches the ambient circumstances in order to make a point that is hard to sustain intellectually. Although it is an apparent paradox that under academic freedom, every point of view, or under destructuralism, there is no such thing as point of view, there is nevertheless the politically correct person and the politically correct position. And I think your book points that out devastatingly.
Excuse me, I have to interrupt at this point. I was sorry, Mr. Buckley, that you brought up God and Man at Yale, because I wanted to bring it up. Mr. Sykes, in particular, and the conservatives in general in this whole debate, crusade under the banner of diversity, of ideas, of toleration. Now, you rose to prominence as a person crusading under the banner of attacking diversity, attacking tolerance and diversity of ideas.
Absolutely.
On college campuses.
Yeah, my
position... Why aren't you telling these people they've got it completely wrong?
No. My position is by no means the position of Professor Sykes on this particular point. He believes in academic freedom to the extent that I do not, to the extent that academic freedom means that all ideas start even in the race, to use a famous metaphor, I think that's oughtn't to be. I think when a professor says, now here's the Declaration of Independence, and here's Marx's manifesto, and I'll tell you why this is a superior document in terms of what we know about ethics, he's doing the correct thing.
But when you were writing about Yale, the Yale establishment held certain beliefs which you said were not being promoted by the professors, and they had a right to assert it. Well, now the Dartmouth establishment, right or wrong, you may be very distressed by it, but Professor Friedman, the trustees of Dartmouth, who write in the Wall Street Journal, all agree with things that you disagree with.
Excuse me.
Why don't they have the right to enforce their own
orthodoxy? The answer is that is not correct. No more did Yale alumni of my age then understand what was being taught than do Dartmouth alumni today. They are perpetually evangelized by the establishment to believe that what's going on in the university is absolutely perfect. And it is a part of alumni fever to believe that what happened in the place you went to school is wonderful.
I think part of this is also an academic ethic that traditionally, no matter how politically biased the professor might have been, he or she felt constrained by a sense of academic ethics not to impose their view upon the class, not to grade on ideological bases, to at least be open to the possibility of disagreement. And that's the kind of thing that I think you see eroded in the politically correct campus, where there's no longer the sense that a student's mind can be open in the class.
Thank you. Charles Sykes, author of Politics and Corruption in Higher Education. Thank you, Professor William Spengemann of Dartmouth. And thank you, Michael. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen of Ridgefield Park.
Funding for Firing Line was made possible by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated. Additional support is provided by the Mobile Corporation. L. John Polite, Jr., the Friends of Firing Line, and by the financial support of viewers like you.